Resource persons, honorable chief guests, patrons, organizing chairperson, secretary, and members of the organizing team. Srimanta Sankaradeva University of Health Sciences aims to create a vibrant academic atmosphere and culture among the health professionals in the state and in the affiliated institutions, and to continuously update health education and research. The motto of the university is excellence in education, research, and development. In keeping with the motto, SSUHS, as we name the university in short, has begun a series of collaborative continuing health education programs. And the first of its kind is today's CHE, that is continuing health education. And this is with the Faculty of Nursing. The university is extremely happy that Asian Institute of Nursing Education has collaborated with SSUHS to bring out this webinar, or the national webinar, on a very relevant and important theme, that is understanding the agony and building emotional resilience during COVID-19 era, the need of the hour. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are about to begin today's webinar. And before beginning, we extend a heartfelt welcome to all the participants, our honored delegates, all the participants. And we welcome you from the core of our heart to today's webinar. So once again, I welcome you here. And to begin with, we would like to invite Professor Deepika Dikka, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Srimanta Sankaradeva University of Health Sciences, for the inauguration. Ma'am, can we have you, please?
A very good morning to you. Good afternoon, I mean. So, Dr. Mansi, how do I inaugurate?
Ma'am, we want an inaugural speech from you.
Okay.
Speeches are so inspiring that we just cannot help listening to you once again.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank Unmona Borghai for arranging this event. I must congratulate her for being the first person. So actually, can you please unmute everything, because there's a lot of echo. I can't even hear my voice. Everybody else has to unmute. Okay, I think the topic that she has chosen is really, really relevant for this time, because a lot of us people are going through a lot of stress at this time. So if you scroll through the social media and look at the news, you will find that you will land up, sweating with the palpitations, panic, fear of infection, fear of dying. You're not the only person. On top of that, the government has given orders for the home stay, social distancing, school and work closure. At least when you're at work, you're meeting friends, you're meeting colleagues. So what happens is that you are feeling a lot of loneliness, you are stressed out, anxiety, depression, and people have reported there are lots of other abuses as well. Now the agony, which is a term which has been used in the heading, depends on the circumstances of different people. For example, a 10th grade girl would be stressed out about her examinations, and she would feel very, very bored. Every day feels like a week, that's what they say. There is this other person, Bijendra Singh, who has been haunted by the voice of his dead wife, Neelam. Why could you not save me, save our baby? Because they were refused entry at 8 hospitals. That is their agony. The battered housewife, whose alcoholic husband grows restless for every day. The mourning relatives who've lost a loved one and struggle to make it to the last rites. The maids, and in fact, people like us who do not get the means to do their work, and actually we've been having to do a lot of housework recently. Then we have the other group of people, the migrant workers' agony, their travel and their travails. They feel that do these workers cease to count if they aren't voters? I was reading up the literature and I found that a survey among the Belgian population, among the 18 to the 65 year old citizens, revealed that before lockdown, only 15% were in stress and 32% of the people were resilient. But after 2 weeks of resilient lockdown, the population stress increased to 25%, which is a very, very large number. The stress in our country is overwhelming. Physical health is a top concern. As we anxiously check for news on containment of COVID-19, we also worry about job losses, financial fallout, schools closures, grief, and uncertainty about what the future holds. So there is a lot of agony. Also, the very high-risk people are the ones who are already suffering from mental and psychological problems, and the poor are more at risk. The daily wage workers really have a lot of agony and stress. Again, history shows that large-scale disasters are often associated with increases in post-traumatic stress disorder, substance abuse disorder, and a range of mental health disorders, including anxiety, depression, domestic violence, and even child abuse. It has been reported that loneliness is a signature mental health concern in the era of the COVID-19 pandemic. So for us health professionals, implications for intervention and social policies need to be focused on. I'm very happy that such a seminar has been organized so that we can focus on them, and maybe we can recommend to the government about what are the interventions that we need to do. It's really not easy. But building coping skills and resilience will help through the emotional uphill triggered by the infection. Now, resilience is a term that has been used. So what is resilience? Resilience is the process of adapting in the face of adversity, trauma, tragedy, or other significant source of stress. Resilience may be viewed as a measure of stress coping ability, and as such could be an important target for treatment in anxiety, depression, and stress reactions. Becoming resilient helps one work not only through difficult events, but also helps one grow and improve life even in the absence of adversity. In fact, after the pandemic goes, there will be more problems about how to cope, because we still don't know what are going to be the problems after the pandemic goes. People would have lost their jobs, people have lost a lot of their dear ones, so on and so forth. Some people refer to resilience as a bouncing back, but it is more than that. Being resilient includes learning from past experiences and developing new coping strategies to move forward. Again, some individuals are more psychologically resilient to adversity than others. Various studies have shown that resilience was greater among those who tended to go outside more often, who did more exercise, and who had more support from their family, friends, and significant one partner. And those who sleep better, who pray more often. Psychological resilience in the face of the pandemic is related to various modifiable factors. So we health professionals, they have a very, very important role to play in whatever capacity we are. So then what are the key factors in building resilience? I will just hint on them so that you can deliberate upon them later on in details. So building resilience is like building muscle when you're doing an exercise. It increasing your resilience requires time and dedication. You can't say I'm going to be strong overnight. If you don't put in the work, it might atrophy. So you really have to put in a lot of work. People are conditioned to think of resilience as a personality trait. No, it's not that. You have to build it. With intention and practice, you can become more and more resilient no matter what your age. Don't think that an elderly person, an adult, is more resilient than a child. In fact, children have better coping capacities than adults. In fact, there is not just one strategy. It is a multi-pronged effort in building your own resilience. Some of them I will just enumerate. You have to build connections, a support network of empathic and compassionate people to help you feel less alone in times of need. I'm very conversant with technology. Therefore, you know, meetings like this, it helps me feel connected. I feel useful. I feel I'm doing something. So such programs like in the Zoom or other app, you know, these are very, very useful. You can do video chat with the friends and family, and this also will help improve. Phone calls, letters. Of course, letters are a problem. They take ages to go. But video calls are very, very common now. So these things really help. In fact, I think most of you know that my family lives in Delhi and I'm here. And for the last 5 months, I'm not able to see them, to visit Delhi. Whereas earlier on, I used to go 2 times in a month. So what do? I feel lonely. So I use video calls and I do Google Duo calls every day or very often. I see my granddaughter. So this makes me feel connected with my family. I connect with my sisters in USA, with my brother, with everybody. So that makes me, I don't feel lonely at all. So that's very, very necessary. You have to connect with your near and dear ones. You have to learn how to cope. Then some things really help, like deep breathing exercises, meditation, and general exercise. Exercise is thought to be a very good stress reliever. And you can walk or you can try a live stream exercise, okay? You must focus on your physical wellness, the immune system. So this is a time that you have some time, you're staying at home, to build up a strong immune system. You have to have good sleep. Sleep for at least 6 or 7 hours, depending upon the age, you see. Elderly people might need longer, they might need a nap in the afternoon as well. Then comes healthy eating. So frankly speaking, I used to eat a lot of fast food and all earlier, because I didn't have time. But now that I have the time, I'm really concentrating on what to eat, healthy food. So you see, this is a time that you can actually build your immunity in such a way. Another thing is hydration. You may not think about it much, but there are lots of studies that hydration can dehydration can exacerbate symptoms of stress. So make sure that you drink plenty of water throughout the day. Very, very important for you to remain active. And activities like this, as you know, even in the university, we are doing a lot of activities. We were waiting for some time, you know, to things to clear up, but doesn't look like COVID is going to go soon. So we are starting with a lot of activities at the university. These activities actually are very, very mentally stimulating, and they will enrich your mind and the spirit. You can do other activities besides academic activities. You can play card games, you can work on a puzzle, you can spend time gardening, or you find a hobby. I know a lot of my friends, they are learning piano after ages, they are painting, they are dancing. So all these things are very, very important to build up your resilience. And these small steps each day can build your resilience muscles, and this will help you through this crisis as well as any future adversity that may come. I was very interested to see that there was a study which shows that social support from family, friends, and a special caring loved ones, where each of them were independently associated with improving your resilience. Also, it has been seen that besides exercise, exposure to sunlight. If you remain in a room with all the curtains drawn, then you feel depressed. You should open the curtains. You should go out into the sunshine, maybe for a few minutes each day, get a little more exercise in the sun, and this will increase your resilience. Finally, spirituality is very, very important. It is another facet of well-being to consider. And there are studies where actually people going to churches, people going to the prayers, you see, you can't go there. So you pray yourself, pray at least as many times that you can in the home, and that will increase your resilience. So I hope that you will be more resilient to the challenges, to mental health imposed by the COVID-19 pandemic by actively engaging in all the activities that I said and nurture your relationships better. So I think I have just given a little summary about how to go ahead, how to increase your resilience and manage the COVID pandemic in at your own level. So I thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me this. I'm actually going to listen because I think the program is going to be very, very interesting. So thank you all and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, ma'am. You have been inspiring as usual, as always, and we will really heed your words and try to improve our life with all the tips that you have given us today. Thank you very much. Now we shall be moving on with this program, and I shall be handing over the rest of the proceedings to Dr. Unmona Borgohain Sarkia, Principal AINE, and also the organizing chairperson of today's webinar. But before that, I would like to say that Professor Gokul Chandra Das, who is one of the patrons, he is the officer on special duty, SSUHS, was supposed to have come today, have joined us, but due to the ill health of one relative, he will not be able to come, but he has sent us all his best wishes for success of this program. Now, a few words about the Asian Institute of Nursing Education. We are very happy that they have taken up this opportunity, and within such a short period, they have organized this webinar. And as we all know, AINE is the first private nursing institute in Northeastern region here. It started in 2004, and Dr. Unmona B. Saikia is the principal of this institution right from the beginning. AINE is currently running BSc NSC Nursing under SNDT Women's University, Mumbai, and is affiliated to this university, SSUHS, for the BSc Nursing courses. Within a short span of time, in 2010, AINE was ranked number one nursing institute in Northeastern region. And AINE has been recognized as the most promising nursing institute in India by Silicon India magazine. The institute has also achieved gold medalist in NSS activities in 2019. So we're happy to be collaborating, and we are glad that they are affiliated under our university. And now over to Dr. Unmona B. Saikia for the rest of the proceedings. Thank you.
Hello.
Dr. Rona, please. Well, so I think there must be some network connections or some technical glitch over there. So we have an array of interesting topics today, which are related to the theme, that is understanding the agony and building emotional resilience during COVID-19. And this is truly the need of the hour. And we are glad that we have an array of topics which will be deliberated upon related to this theme.
Hello, ma'am.
Please continue.
okay. So it's a ma'am, we cannot hear you again.
Can you hear me now, Dr. Unmona? From my side, it's all right. I can hear you. Hello?
I can't hear. Tell her to increase the volume. I don't know what she's doing. Something is wrong in her connection. Mansi?
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Unmona?
Phone her. She can't hear you. Wow. Phone her.
Yes, ma'am.
विजय मैम, प्रिंसिपल मैम को हेल्पफुल यूज करने के लिए बोलिए ना मैम।
कैन यू हियर मी नाउ?
Ma'am, we can hear you now, ma'am.
You can hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
But we can't see you. You adjust your screen. Okay, now this is better.
Okay, ma'am. It's a very, like, you know, big day for us. I can say university is extending a hand and to go forward for the continuous education. As it is a collaborative healthcare service, we cannot do work independently, only one department. It is a collaborative team is required. However, on the very onset, I wanted to extend my deepest gratitude to Madam Professor Deepika Deka, who asked me, can you do something together? This is just a thought. This is
ma'am, we cannot hear you again. Ma'am, please use headphone, no? Ma'am, no, ma'am, we cannot hear you. Ma'am, we cannot hear.
Something is wrong with her laptop, whatever she's using. You should change it.
Hello, madam, please unmute your speaker. Speaker is unmuted, ma'am.
I'm still, it's unmute.
Yes, I can hear me now. Yes.
Hello. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes. So continuing, I think there's a technical glitch over there. We are not getting over it. So I would like to invite Dr. Lalu Joseph to continue with the deliberation. Joseph is a quality controller at CMC Vellore, the Christian Medical College Vellore, and I invite Dr. Lalu to please continue with the deliberation.
Thank you very much for that platform that is provided to me. Am I audible, madam?
Yes, I can hear you.
You can hear me. Okay. I will start sharing my presentation. Yeah. Can you see my presentation, madam?
Yes, it's visible. Visible.
Thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity given to me and for the wonderful topic that is assigned. Thanks, Dr. Unmona, for this great platform. My talk will be on minding sensitive care to its patients with pain during COVID-19. And I represent the 15 Medical College below and also the Consortium of Accredited Healthcare Organizations of India as Secretary General. Now, I will begin my talk with none other than Florence Nightingale. Florence Nightingale's visionary understanding the environmental impact on patients' health, pioneer of the concept of healing environment. Her notes on hospital, in the book she wrote, the appropriate adjustments in the environment can avoid illnesses. And that is the concept with which we have been working around, trying to make our hospitals more user-friendly, patient-friendly, and creating an environment physically healthy and psychologically appropriate for the clientele that we cater to. All this indirectly contribute to the patient's outcomes, shorter length of stay, reduced stress, and increased patient satisfaction. So this is the background with which we work in our hospitals, making our hospitals as friendly as possible for our patients. Now look at what we are doing in a pandemic era. Flu clinic at the entrance of the hospital. Is it something that can be avoided? Definitely no. It is the need and the norm of the hour. So for a patient who's entering into the hospital, to see such people sitting with the mask, with the hazmat kind of a suit, and with all the personal protective environment, it is very scary. We as healthcare workers, we don't understand the psyche actually of the patients who are coming in. Now imagine a situation when they enter in and they see people like astronauts sitting there. Now come to this, a thermal scanner straight to the forehead of the patient to check the temperature. Now there are various jokes around this. What if the man is actually pointing a gun? Now, it's very scary for a patient to go through such things. Look at this. When they come into the emergency department, this is what they see. In a flu clinic, this is what they see. Now, they really don't know whether they are talking to a doctor, a nurse, a technician, nothing. So totally that concept is lost. Previously, we used to at least associate a doctor with a stethoscope that is hanging around the neck or with a white coat. Now, today, in the three people who are walking, you really don't know whether that person is a housekeeping person or a doctor or a nurse. Nobody. Nobody can really make out who that person is. Visitor restriction all over the place. Entry restriction. Relatives are not allowed with the COVID patients. Now you have non-COVID patients who are in our hospitals where we have restrictions with maybe one attendant or one visitor who's entering. Social distancing. Boxes like this. You're not allowed to stand close to anybody, wear your mask and into the lift. Mask is mandatory, two people, three people. It's a very, very scary atmosphere that we have in our hospitals today. Now, in the name of cleaning the place, we make our patients get up, start cleaning every 1 hour. And there are hospitals that make the announcement every 2 hours. Can all the patients please stand up because it's now time to clean all the chairs. So, I know our way of functioning has totally turned. It is a total paradigm shift, I will say, from a regular functioning to what we are now, you know, adopting to a new norm in our hospitals. Look at this. Like spray guns, we are spraying our campuses with all disinfectants. I don't know whether this is really useful at all. But yes, we are doing it all the time. And this is a very scary experience. Imagine somebody giving their throat or a nose for a swab. For a patient who doesn't know what is going to happen, it's a very, very scary experience. So coming into the hospital is extremely scary today. And the paradigm shift in communication is what we are experiencing during this COVID era. We as healthcare workers or providers really do not know how to communicate to the patients or what to communicate to the patients. Because the fear is mutual. It is not just with the patients. it is with us as well. We have our dear ones and loved ones in our hospitals, and therefore we need to take care of them as well. So it is extremely difficult situation that we are going through. And in this point in time, what can we actually offer to our patients is what I am going to touch upon. The physical toll, the exhaustion on the healthcare workers is terrible. I have a son who is interning, and he goes into the labor room. He comes out drenched. Please mute themselves. Thank you. So the physical toll is on all the healthcare workers. It is an exhaustion that you see. It is not easy to wear the mask, the N95 masks, and walk around. You just cannot breathe properly. It is so difficult walking around with that. So with that, how do we keep ourselves cheerful and communicate what is needed for our patients? We have to have a considerate mind. We have to understand that we are the last resort for the patients and relatives who are coming to us. We just have to let go that this exhaustion is going to eat us. It's going to really be a stress for us. That 6 hours, 8 hours, we really have to go that extra mile to take care of that patient and relative who's coming to us. So it is very important to identify the roles as a doctor, as a nurse, in the OPD, in the inpatient area. The patient needs to know, I am so and so. There are hospitals that have actually put the pictures of the nurses and doctors onto the suit and saying that I am so and so. It is a good thing to put that down. At least to say that I am a healthcare worker, you can talk to me. You can relate to me with my name. So it is very important that we identify ourselves with our roles. Physical toll, I mentioned about it earlier. The situational response is what is very important at this point in time. In high stress situations that we are going through, people process information very differently. What we try to communicate is not what they understand. It is totally different because the mind is blocked. To them, it is only that positive corona. You know, I'm corona positive, or my relative is corona positive. Or, you know, if it's a non-COVID patient, how do I protect myself from the others who are walking around? So it is a high stress situation. So we must realize that people process information very differently. So we have to go that extra mile to make them understand. We have to keep our messages very short, very simple, with a very simple language. Avoid using any medical jargons and go ahead and repeat what you are saying multiple times so that the patients and the relatives understand exactly what you are trying to say. No harm in repeating. Keep it as short, as simple, and go ahead and repeat your messages. Under stress, we must realize that people focus on negatives more than the positives. So we have to try and avoid speaking negative statements to them. Make it a more positive experience. Talk positively. Speak to them in a very positive tone. Smile. So what is most important is that they are looking for clues. They are looking for negative statements. Am I audible? Yeah. So what I would stress upon is positive messages should definitely outnumber the negative messages. Keep your positive messages to 75% and keep that negative message to 25%. As much as positive, as much as possible, provide positive impact to the patients. Quick tips, some of the quick tips to connect with your patients. Be present. Make introductions. Explain to them, I am Dr. So-and-so. I am nurse so-and-so. And this is what I am here for. I am here to take care of you. So it is good at this point in time to be make yourself present. How am I feeling? Do I know whom I am meeting? So talk to them, understand them, get their name. Who are you? I am so-and-so. That is very important. identify their needs. Do I know what they expect? What assumptions am I making? Even before asking the patient, am I assuming certain things that this patient must be having fever? He must be having a cold. He must be having a cough. Am I assuming things? What can I expect from them? Ask open-ended questions. How are you feeling today? What can I do for you? Ask open-ended questions and allow them to talk. The most important thing of the lot is listening. What are they trying to say? What are they feeling? What is their emotion? Are they drained? Are they scared? Are they worried? Are they upset? Listen from both the content and also the emotion. Watch out carefully for their eyes. Resist from interrupting. It is very clearly put down that healthcare workers, every 20 seconds, they interrupt the patients. They assume. So it is best that we sit and listen to our patients without assuming things, and both in content and also emotion. Respond and provide empathy. It is not sympathy. Why has it happened? Empathize with them. Put yourself in their shoe and validate the emotion. You can actually show emotions to make sure that you tell them that you empathize with them. Share information. How to be clear and concise. As I mentioned earlier, precise, short, simple, repeat. And tell information in very small bites, not very elaborate, and some brochure in hand and give it to them. All those are very, very impersonal ways of communicating, particularly at this point in time when you have a pandemic in front of you. Let me tell you, my dear friends, eyes are the best tools, I would say. Whatever PPE you wear, your eyes are still seen. Your eyes are a window to the world. You can show your emotion through your eyes. Smile. You may think your lips are hidden under the N95 mask that you are wearing. But when you smile, your eyes smile along with it. So it is extremely important that your eyes, your emotions are shown through the eyes. So please make eye contact with your patients when you are talking to them. And make a smile. Understand that your eyes project what you mean. This is you have to really look into this. Calmer is an acronym that is used. Check in when you're getting into the patient room. Check in. Ask about the condition. Lay out the issues to them. Motivate them to talk. Allow them to talk. Ask them to talk. You have to expect certain emotions. They may break down. They may tell you their problems. But expect those emotions and be prepared. Record the discussions. C for check-in. A for ask about the condition, the COVID. Lay out the issues. L, M, motivate to talk. Expect emotions and record the discussion. If you are able to do this, we will have a good contact with our patients. Now, the most difficult situation is here in an ICU setting. We think that they are under the machines, but they know what is happening around them. So it is very important that touch, going, talking to them, telling them what's happening is extremely important. At least be seen that we are empathizing with them. So we have to be very careful in communicating physically to the patients in the ICU setting. Treat them well and also understand whatever we do, it is that communication which is going to help us get through this pandemic. Because it is not just the patients whom we don't know. It is our own good ones, well ones, and our own relatives, colleagues who are patients. And we are patients also too. We may expect ourselves to go into such a situation. What we would expect our doctors and nurses to be telling us is what we should be doing for our patients. Let me tell you, this is an excerpt from Dr. Ida Scudder, who is the founder of Christian Medical College, Vellore, in 1922. To her very first batch of medical students, and all of whom were women. And she said, in 1922, she said to all her women graduates, you will not only be curing diseases, but will also be battling with epidemics, plagues, and pestilences and preventing them. You must learn to be cool, collected, and quiet, to have presence of mind, rapid thought, and in the most trying situations. You must learn to have wise judgment in moments of great peril. Practice and experience will train you to have firmness and courage. Do not always look out for gratitude, for sometimes when you are most deserving, you will get the least. There will be care, anxieties, which are very common to any professional life. These are the valleys into which you descend, but stand up bravely, be true, and keep on climbing. This is an excellent quote, I should say. And I must tell you, this is to all of you. This thank you note to all the heroes who are in the front, all the nurses, particularly the nurses who contribute 80% of the healthcare workforce, particularly women. Thank you so much for everything you do, both in facing this pandemic and before it. You have taken care of families at every step from birth to death. You are now walking right into the fire to help humanity get through these tough times. And this first presentation, my dear friends, is dedicated to you for your strength, your resilience and care. Thank you once again for this wonderful opportunity that is provided to me, Dr. Udmona, and the university. And I really am indebted to all of you for this. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, madam.
Okay. On the very onset, I could not introduce you, but about Madam Lalu Joseph, I can say she's one of the excellent teacher. And we understand, and we the doctors and nurses are not enough to run the hospital at the present era. We can see without technology, we are handicapped. And she's basically from the BE from mechanical, then she has done her MBA in the CQI from Canadian. Then she became the quality manager in the CMC Vellore and for a very long time. And particularly at presently, she's working as an NABH principal assessor and quality control of India implementation of the protocol. So like madam is involved or ensuring the quality in the hospital. And she, all over the India, she is visiting the hospital on the tour every time, I can say. So like, I am very much honored, ma'am, to have you over here for giving your time today. And I understand that, like, you know, what we do, how we do, it is very important. And you being from engineering background, that being involved with the healthcare such a long period, you have observed as a third person too. And as a person, the first person too, for the creating the infrastructure. So you have really explained very well that your topic, minding considered care towards patient with pain during COVID-19, because we missed out many things. And you have beautifully said about the balancing of both positive and negative. Yes, it is like a seesaw. If we have the lot of negatives, particularly we have the few negatives like loss of job and no school, even for the general people, and the physical distancing, and otherwise, if we can give the some of the support, psychological support, family support, some facilities even without job, so it will balance the seesaw. So thank you very much, ma'am, for giving your time. And as you have, Madam Lalu has said, if you have any queries to her, she may not be there till end. And she will be even answering through her email too, or if anything is there, immediately can, and she can give some time, like open to, like any questions are there in the sir? Ma'am, are you going to stay with us for till end?
If you could excuse me, Udmona, I'd be very happy to answer to any queries now, and later on, probably they can raise their questions. I'm happy to answer them by email. If you're okay.
Ma'am, at present, no questions.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. I'm very sorry for inconvenience in the beginning that I could not get connected. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
A lot. Bye-bye.
Bye, ma'am. Bye. Thank you so much. Next, we'll go to the next speaker for today. And again, I would like to, welcome Madam Dr. Ms. Pratima Naik. She is matron in KM Hospital, Mumbai, also working as superintendent of nursing service office for recruitment for the Maharashtra. For 9 years, she was the bedside nurse, 16 years as a teaching faculty, and 2 years till date she is a matron, and she is PhD, she has done from TISS Health System Studies, MSc Nursing SNDT CTBS, and post basic BSc Nursing again, Diploma in Trade Unionism Industrial Relation, PGDHF, DNEA, Diploma and Rural Research. These are her qualifications. Madam, I welcome you and to highlight us and give the depth of the knowledge on solicited responsive towards COVID-19 warriors. Welcome you, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, one and all. I especially first would like to thank Asian Institute of the Nursing Education, ASAM, that you have given me an opportunity to be a part of this webinar. The emergence of the COVID in the Wuhan, the People Republic in the China in December 2019, and it spread in the India in March 2020, has made the closure of all the sectors and institutions of the country and compelled to be at home inevitably. The contain and the spread of this coronaviruses and to prepare a dramatic increase in the demand of limited hospital and medical facilities and resources. Consequently, there have been a limitation to use of the public transports, public place, work, education, and the recreational facilities. Aside from the social distancing, and putting as one of the armorers of the basic health hygiene and using the nose mask, COVID-19 pandemic has no curative vaccine till date to stop. But further the spread and our COVID-19 warriors came forward to fight against the battle of the coronavirus. Each and every member involved in the elimination of the COVID-19 warriors, example, the health team members like management, administrations, doctors, nurses, paramedics, the lab technician, dietitians, physiotherapists, and ancillary staff, etc., had come forward today to be a warrior. Let me start in presentation. Can everybody see my presentation?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So the warriors are even every individual who has participated in this COVID-19. Today, I got a very important topic, that is a solicitous response towards the COVID-19 warriors. It's a team of each and every individual has worked directly or indirectly for the COVID-19. All the team members has overlooked their problems, issue faced by them, and gave a solicitous response for the COVID-19 work. And they are all the real warriors. Now, coming to some organization-wise data of the warriors, you can see n number of the people who had participated. Specifically, the health team members plays a vital role during the pandemics and taking lead in the preparation of the outbreak. Early recognition and preparation for the increasing threat, managing the staff challenges along with the well-being of the members. It was also been observed that one index case may infect many of the people. Therefore, there are so many people or the warriors has come in front and shows the possibility. You can see the big figures. It's the figures are in the lakhs that people have participated. Even you can see the nurses, more than 17 lakh nurses has been involved in the healthcare. So same way, you can see the different hospitals, including the volunteers, even the NCC, the lab volunteers, the port hospitals, the trained professionals, then healthcare workers, physio-social workers, then even the panchayat secretaries are the part of the health teams. Now, there are the warriors where they're required. In the health services, like, for example, the fever screening, the center-wise, the fever screening sub-center-wise, COVID center, dedicated health centers, dedicated hospital, non-COVID hospital, fever treatment, and the health control rooms. There we require the warriors who really hasn't worked. Now the responses which is given by the management and the administrators. Now first response, like when the guidelines are being issued or ordered by the government or the competent authority to overcome the issues and to treat these patients, COVID patients. So first thing, the response was been given by the management and the administration, that is organizing a planning committee. In that planning committee, whether the committee of the doctors, nurses, the health team members, the electricians, the civils, whoever are the responsible persons has made the different types of the committees. After that, there was a clear decision-making structure. In the clear decision-making structures, there was a hierarchy made by the authority, then there was in delegations and responsibilities to the each of the team members, and simultaneously the authority was given to these persons so that the clear cut decision making can be done for an easy work. Thirdly, there is an surveillance, screening and evaluation strategies. Always, it was found that the waves of the patients coming, so the surveillance was very important, followed by whatever the things was there to be screened off, and the evaluation and the re-evaluation of the strategies so that the new strategies or the best strategies can be planned off. Next is the plan to rapid implementation, effective infection control measures and the contact tracing procedures was been planned or the response was been seen. In that, there was a very important phenomena of the segregation and the waste disposal. As the COVID is being contagious, so the waste generated has to be disposed very cautiously. Then, the prevention of the cross infections, the swab collections procedures and the policies to be are been formulated by the hospital's management so that it can ease in the prevention of the infection. Another aspect was that the current availability of the infrastructure and the resources of the care for patients and the strategies for meeting the increasing demands. We can see every individual knows that the huge wave of the patients had been come together and it was very difficult to manage within the availability of the resources and to provide the high quality of the care. Therefore, the choice based on the moral grounds in order to maintain our professional integrity and meet the demands, it was been found that the necessary structures can be modified into the different aspects. For example, making a triage area, making a reception area, then preparing of the ICU, then separations of the patient from the COVID and non-COVID patients, then the patients when become the swab negative, separation of that patient, etc., has been prepared in the very short duration. Next is the strategies to meet the staffing need for the patient care and the management. So each and every individual who was delegating the responsibility and the duties has been changed. So the new assignments of their duties, their responsibilities, their requirements, and making the resources available are certain responses which was been given by the administration. Next aspect is the strategies to communicate with the staff, patient, the health department, and the public. In the staff department, the response of the administration was given as use of the mobile, small WhatsApp group, direct communications, indirect communication, so that, as the madam said, it should be a short communication which can be easily understood. Department-wise communication was been established by the emails, phones, preparing of the dashboards, exchange of the data, preparation of the war room so that the data is readily available to the exchange either to hospital or to the government or to the health ministry. So this was been prepared in the departmental wise, and to the public there was preparation of the speakers, utilization of the mass media, then the issue of the emergency numbers, even the disaster management cell numbers, etc., was been displayed so that the public awareness can be created. Next is the strategies to educate the staff and the patient about the COVID-19 and other monsoon diseases and control the measures. Here in this COVID and non-COVID department was been established, and accordingly the service education is given to each and every individual. Further slides we can discuss about in details. Now, very important that the nurse administrators' responses towards, specifically towards the health team members and to the nurses. Very important was that education. Education, because the COVID was an unique and it was not well-versed about the treatment and about the disease condition. Therefore, conducting the seminars, conferences, webinars online was been done. Apart from that, in-house training programs, which was been conducted, and regular the notices on the board where there was an changes in the protocols was been given. Apart from that, provision of the study material where our health team members, as per their liabilities, they can read it and they can understand. There was an approach of the trainers, which was been followed in the various establishments so that the trainers can train the other people. And other than the non-essential training were suspended for certain time so that the importance was been given to the COVID-19. Second aspect is the skill upgradation. Now, skill upgradation is very important, as Madam Lalu has discussed about how the communication and how we required the skill. As she said, by the smile also we can make out. The establishment or the organization of the nursing commands post was been created so that to coordinate the effort across the different nursing units has been confirmed. Nursing leaders were been identified so that they can lead the team, and small units can be identified and we can upgrade their skills. Like that, same way, the ICU management short courses was been given. And secondly, the drug teaching, that is the drugs which has been newly came into the market where the nurses were not aware of this drug. So very important phenomena, the drug was been taught to the nurses. Then, as madam said, the soft skills was been very important, as we are handling the patients without the relatives. Sometimes it happens when the patients are admitted, the patient's relatives are not there. The patient's relatives have been quarantined. The individual, the alone patient comes that time. As she said, the patient has a lot of fears and anxiety. So to touch and to identify and to deal with a patient which was been taught. And last, rituals preparation, like the ordinary rituals are the different than the COVID-19 patient rituals. So that was been also the skills were been taught to the health team members to handle the matters. Next is the mental response or the mental preparation. The preparation of the health team member and their family members for accepting the situations, the duties and the responsibility. Initially, as madam said, everybody was under the stress that whether we will suffer from the COVID-19 and we may get some sort of illness and which will be spread out to our families and to the communities. So preparation was been done to each and every health team member so that they can take up their duties and responsibilities. Simultaneously, to acceptance of this situation, the guidance and counseling was been provided. Fourthly, the physical preparation. The physical preparation, as madam said, that we have identified the comorbidity, what all the aspect or the disease has been carried by our health team member to avoid from the COVID areas. Their physical health checkup was been performed. The importance was been given on their diets. Then appropriate accommodation facilities was been given to them. And very important is that the prophylaxis treatment was given under the strict supervision of the administrators. Next aspect is that the social acceptance. Now, social acceptance of the working nurses, not only the nurses, but the health team members in the COVID areas among the colleagues, families and community. Because initially, when there was a lack of knowledge, every individual was scared that, yes, this person has worked in the COVID. Probably that patient may or the person may transfer the infection to me also. So there was a non-acceptance by the family also. Even in the society also, there are the incidences occurred that the stones was being thrown on the health team members not to enter the society so that there was an, they will not enter it. But later on, as the, with the help of the police and with an education in the mass and media, this matter was been also covered very positively. As Madam Abbott said, the spiritual preparation in the initially, Madam told about the spiritual preparation. So in the spiritual preparation, we organize some sort of meditations, yoga, and the stress management activity in the form of the leisure activities we had given to them. Now, very important that my warriors has faced certain challenges, and then to overcome these challenges, they gave a very positive responses, and then they have worked very enthusiastically in the hospital premises, even in the society. First point is that there is a lack of synchronicity. So it was been found due to, it may be an hurried decisions or it may be hurried orders. Because of that, there was a non-involvement in the planning. Secondly, there was a disharmony and the lack of health team work. And the employees felt that they are used as a handmaiden attitude. But every individual employees has taken it very optimistically, and every individual has done their best, and they took the initiative to work all towards the department, worked in the health team as they can coordinate with each other, and they overcome this issue. Second issues is that shortage of the equipments and the materials. Example, the drugs, emergency equipments like the ventilators, N95 PPE kits, then the dead body packing bags, etc. Immensely, it was been communicated to the authority about this shortages, and finally the team made an adaptations which has been available resources which can be utilized in the various departments. And this problem also they overcome with an adaptation to the situations. Next aspect is that shortage of the employees. As in the throughout the India or throughout the world, there was a lockdown. In the lockdown period, there were the things which was been not available. The containment zones were there so that the employees were not allowed to come out of their houses. There was an issues of the lot of quarantine people so that there was been found shortage. There was a non-availability or the limited transport to travel down to the employees. But these employees made an effort to stay within the campus or in the nearby campus so that they can serve to the organization. Also, we had a recruitment new employees on the contractual basis so that we can fulfill the requirements. I should happily say that the employees had given very positive responses that they left their house months together. They have been staying near or inside the campus and serving the organizations. The next aspect is that the mental health impact from overwork. Initially, there was a very exhaustive work done by the health team members of the 12 hours duty. Finally, when we found that there is an overexertion, we made into the 8 hours duty. After 8 hours duty, because there was a lot of humidity in the various places, wearing with the PPE for a longer hours, then inappropriate ventilations, then when you are wearing the PPE, not allowed it for the food and water as there is a chance of the contaminations. Also, the natural calls could not be attended due to the shortage of the PPEs.
due to this, all the aspect, the health administrators overcame with a positive response, and the duties was been given for the 6 hours, so that this can be overcome and every individual can be get and some sort of relaxations. Next aspect, the hospital employee seen as a risk, not a solution. It is always thought that no, that person may give an infection to me, our own colleagues, our own families, societies, and the communities. So this aspect was being made understood by their family members, so that they can overcome these issues, and acceptance was been readily given by the people. Another aspect was that workplace health hazards. Workplace health hazards was been seen, that is, when the employees become positive, COVID positive, their admissions, the place of their COVID duties, their accommodations, their food, and quarantine places. So initially, it was been very difficult to these employees to get admitted, and how to make them these organizations adjustments. As the diseases waves of the facility was been provided, and the accommodation of the positive COVID positive health workers was been made to a specific ward or the hospitals. Then there was a patients and the relative concern, as already discussed by madam, that there was without patients, relatives, the patients were been admitted, patients were been very panic in that state. Certain protocols we had made, and then after that we have seen to it that the patients and the relatives are being given a proper information by the communication systems. Next is the class 4 employees issues and the shortage, as due to the quarantines or the fear, because their literacy is little lesser, so that they got more frightened and they have been away from these jobs. So therefore, we made an opportunity to call the class 4 employees or the ancillary services people, and we have educated them. We made them to stay in a campus, provided the necessary facilities so that they can be with us. Very important thing that challenges faced by my warriors is that the burnout. Lot of scary environments, working hours, the rest, and there was an scary feelings that what can occur. So the duties were been planned in a such a way that they will get a rotation duty, appropriate resting hours was been provided, and arrangement of the adequate inventories and equipment so that the stress and strain can be relieved.
Hello,
I don't know why.
Ma'am Pratima, we cannot hear anything.
Hello, Pratima, we can't hear you. Hello.
हेलो मैम प्रतिमा हेलो
विजया का कॉल हर
यस मैम
she might be receiving phone or what Vijaya hello
ma'am I think
this is for Vijaya
hello
Vijaya did you get her
ma'am she cut the phone
okay what to do we'll go to the next speaker
yes ma'am I'll send message from this end
she might be in the busy for something or hospital regarding so yes, shall we get ready with the Suresh sir okay sir is there probably you start the slide sharing since there sabhi Vijaya
yes ma'am
madam is since there I think
hello yeah I'm sorry there wasn't some so there was a little interruption in the connection
okay,
so these okay. Yeah so these all the aspect like the nurses has come over or the health team members has been health team member had come with an positive responses so I'm really thankful for giving this opportunity to me thank you so much
okay thank you so much madam that out of your so hectic and busy schedule that I can understand whatever is going on in your state and you have given us so much of time and you have highlighted so many areas that we have really need to be careful and as we have purposely selected this topic that there is a crisis of manpower crisis of physical infrastructure it is not just easy to get it right now but if we have our emotional tool with us like you know toolbox then we can help the other healthcare member and whatever facilities available if we can arrange it appropriately with our innovative management definitely we can overcome the stress and thank you very much ma'am for giving your time and sharing your knowledge with us thank you once again ma'am okay now we are proceeding to our next topic our speaker is here sir Dr. Suresh Chakravarty He will be talking with the topic comprehensive and juvenile psychological care towards the COVID-19 survivor. Sir, he is the head of the Department of Psychiatry, Guwahati Medical College Hospital, and he is sir is also like postgraduate from Guwahati Medical College only. And he is also the subject expert of PhD committee of Srimanta Shankaradeva University of Health Sciences, Guwahati. He is an inspector of MCI Gov of India. At present, he is also a member of core committee of State Mental Health Authority and was a committee member appointed by Honorable Guwahati High Court for accessing the mental health status of Assam. He is a past honorary secretary of IPS Assam State Branch. And he is a speaker, chairperson of various journal, national, international CME and conferences. In Assam, apart from being a psychiatrist, he is much more familiarly known as a short story writer, the recipient of Best Short Story Writer Award under 25, bestowed by Assam Sahitya Sabha in 1983. He has published more than 150 short stories, including two books. His book stories have been translated to Bangla, Hindi languages. Sir, we are looking forward to hear from you. It is the another challenge for the survivor to adjust in the community to come back to the normal life. Looking forward, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sumana Borgohan, Principal ASEAN Institute of Nursing Education. I am really grateful to you and you people for giving me this opportunity for sharing some of my thoughts. Also grateful to the Vice Chancellor Srimanta Shankardev University of Health Sciences, Dr. Deepika Dekha Ma'am. I also thankful to Academic Registrar Dr. Mansi. And my topic is the care and concern for the COVID warrior, those who have survived from the COVID warrior. So let's go to that topic. Have you seen this? Yes, have you seen this?
Yes, sir, we can see your slides.
Yeah, fine, thank you. So the topic of this afternoon discussion is the psychological care for COVID-19 survivors. Now, the term COVID is not new. It is known since 1960, and there were 7 different types of COVID till now. Now, whatever we are familiar with where the pandemic is going on is the COVID-19. So it is an infectious disease caused by severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2. We used to call it SARS-CoV-2. It was first identified in December 2019 in Wuhan, town of Hubei district of China, and has resulted in an ongoing pandemic. On January 30th, all of us know that who has confirmed this novel virus as public health emergency of international concern. And it was declared a pandemic, although by late of 11 March. It took 2 months for WHO to announce it as pandemic, which has created mass controversy all over the world. The worst affected countries are the USA, Brazil, India, Italy, Spain, China, France, Germany, UK, and so on and so forth. Now, for any kind of health disasters or any kind of pandemic or any kind of epidemic, there are some psychological events in case of mental health. So we used to call it the alarm reactions. And what are those reactions? So the mental health impact on people are very profound, and it is broad spectrum. And basically, it is the anxiety problem, the anxiety, that emotional outburst, anger, irritability, sadness, grief, loss of freedom, shame, guilt, anxiety, and worry of uncertain future, of worst possible outcome, whatever we are facing nowadays, everyone. The fear of having the disease, fear of having the contaminations, fear regarding somebody is coughing in front of us, fear regarding having some sort of sore throat, fear of having fever, any kind. So leads to that, suppose we are, as if we are having the coronavirus. And that leads to the feeling of insecurity, uncertainty, feeling of numbness. If I have been going to have the corona, I have to stay in the isolation, I have to stay in the ICU, I required your ventilation, so and so forth. And there's a series of reactions. And if it lasts long, then ultimately, it has, what I wanted to say you that it is not only the medical problem, it is a great social problem, it is the economic problem, it is the psychological problem. And the sequelae of all these events used to occur in the form of suicidal idea, homicidal thoughts or ideas, or suicidal attempts, thought of mass suicide, if the it is happening. It is happening nowadays in the your daily labor or daily wage earner. Then murder, mass grief bereavement, dissociation, mass hysteria, blaming, boredom, or loneliness. But these are the common reactions. But what happened in case of those who have survived? Those who have survived, those who have caused the disease and they have survived from the disease. So there are some peculiar reactions apart from the above said reaction, the above said symptoms. the mental health among COVID-19 survivors, that since the coronavirus has been come into the world, that people started reporting that it has been rapidly transmitted and has aroused enormous global attention. Infected patients may develop severe and even fatal respiratory syndrome, such as acute respiratory distress syndrome and acute respiratory failure, and ending up in intensive care. And that is the most dangerous things people used to scare of. Patients with COVID-19 diagnosed are treated under isolation. And that is one of the horrible things why people are scared of the COVID. People are not scared of influenza, or not scared of cough, or not scared of your fever. But people are scared of keeping or staying in the isolation or in fear of your intensive care. So in hospital and with high stress level, because during that time, patient has to stay alone. Nobody is allowed to see him. Nobody is allowed to contact with him except in mobile phone. And during the treatment, isolation made patients gradually alienated to each other. On the other hand, arthritis of disease prognosis and the threat of death, psychological health problems like depression or anxiety were more likely to occur and worsen. Because although it was said that earlier that it is the comorbid people, those who are above 60, those who are having comorbidity of the disease, suppose hypertension, diabetes, cancer, they are more vulnerable to develop fatal consequences. But recently that characteristic of the virus has been changed. Simple cases of a man without any comorbidity, a young man of 30 years of age, has been also died. So that is again frightful. That is again very, very panic, and that is again very painful. Distress and psychological impact on patients were also correlated significantly with several adverse psychological effects, such as fatigue due to the fever or due to the environment, fear of social contact, poor sleep in the new environment, loneliness in the new environment, and depressed mood due to the consequences, due to the disease itself. Now, what are the factors responsible for mental health distress in COVID-19 survivors? These are mostly psychosocial in nature, and it includes social isolation and stigmatization. In ever, probably it is the first one who keeps the individual on social isolation. In other endemic, other pandemic, people are not so much lonely, not so much isolated like this time. So it's a quite novel experience for those who have developed this illness. So loneliness is again one, the same research. Feeling of fear that so many people are contaminated here, I also contaminated. If their contamination affect me, their severity affect me, so the feeling of fear. Then helplessness, if I'm going to die, nobody will come to me, nobody can do the last rites to me. So I have been kept isolated, everything has been done by the government or the government machinery. So these sort of things, helplessness is to come. Anxiety related to the essential supplies, job security, and concern about contracting the virus again. Whether I am having virus today, but who can guarantee me that I am not going to suffer again in the future after my quarantine is over? So it is quietly unseen, unpredictable virus, and that leads to the main problem to the survivors. So the coronavirus survivors, that is why they are more at the risk of PTSD. So in case of acute reaction, we call it acute stress reaction, which is manifested by acute anxiety, restlessness, fear of contamination, immediate effect, appear of immediate happening or impending death. But when it lasts 1 month, after 1 month, it takes the picture of the post-traumatic stress disorder. And what are the characteristics? It is still too early to predict how many people will be infected with the virus all over the world, as the number of causes and deaths continues to rise. Till today, there is more than 1.8 crores people all over the world is suffering from this virus. Meanwhile, millions of people are scared and even panic of the possible loss of health, life, and wealth. Some of our we have seen, some of our relatives we have seen, some of them we have seen in our newspaper, some of we have seen in the digital media. The experience you are witnessing the suffering related to COVID-19 may result in high prevalence of post-traumatic disorder. It is not only those who have get the disease is supposed to develop PTSD. It is the caregiver also who has taken care of these people, or those who have seen in the digital media, in the television, in the social network, they are also more vulnerable to the development of PTSD. And that is why, so it is the family members who provide first aid, and caregivers, medical and public health professionals like police officer, etc., and even among the general public are more vulnerable to develop PTSD. While control of the epidemic and care of the patients with COVID-19 are still the dominant task of the whole world, but there is a need for attention to early intervention and prevention of PTSD among affected population also. Because today or tomorrow, the COVID will go sooner or later, but its consequences, the devastating effect of psychological effect of it will remain month after month in the world, and that we have to look after, how to prevent this PTSD. Now, PTSD may plague many COVID survivors. Infectious disease and PTSD exposure to infection disease, epidemic results, and particular type of psychological trauma, which could be categorized into three groups. Number one, so that first, the directly experiencing and suffering from the disease, and which is also traumatic. For example, dyspnea, respiratory failure, alteration of consciousness state, threatening of death, tracheostomy, etc., for the treatment purpose, are major trauma of patients with severe COVID-19. I have seen a person who has gone through this phase. He said that, "I have never ever experienced this sort of respiratory failure, respiratory distress in my life." So such a huge, he has seen that with clear conscience that he is having that loss of your breathlessness, and he cannot help it out. The second is the witnessing the patients who suffer from, struggle against and die of the infectious disease, and especially for the respiratory distress. There's, in the initial stage, there was lack of ventilation, lack of oxygen support, and it is the caregiver, it is the doctors, it is the working nurse, it is who has seen the patient dying without oxygen. And that is again a very, very traumatic for the caregivers, especially the first headline warrior, or headline warrior. The third is experiencing the realistic or unrealistic fear of infection. Those who have seen, or those who have heard in the media, or those who have viewed continuously in the media, and seeing the breaking news all throughout. And these media houses, especially the visual media, they used to highlight the more and more of the same topics in a very, very unrealistic manner, very, very scary manner, and that leads to the PTSD. Now, what is the road ahead for us? How we can control? I have said that, yes, for acute stress, we can take care of. There is counseling, there is medical treatment, so we can take care of the COVID-19, medical point of view or psychological point of view. But what about its consequences? How we can going to take care of its consequences, which is going to be faced by the medical or the psychological or the mental health professional, including the psychological health worker, clinical psychologist, psychiatric social worker, and the rehabilitation counselist. So for patients who become seriously ill with COVID-19, survival may only mark the start of a complex recovery path. So medical team and all the ICU team, they can make the patient survive fast. Okay, fine. So along with potentially coping with the cardiac, the initial stage of cardiac, pulmonary, and other physical effects, psychologists report that patients may have to sort through cognitive changes such as difficulty with attention and memories, as well as mental health symptoms for months to come. Whatever I'm saying, that these experiences, they cannot forget in one day. Some difficulties such as post-traumatic stress disorder may be rooted in their experiences with hospital care and intensive care treatment, and which is very long-lasting. Psychologists fear that other challenges such as survival guilt. What is survival guilt? Suppose I am with the other patients in a ICU. My neighboring patient has been dying. So although I am happy that I have survived, I have seen him dying. So that is called survival guilt. The same thing that if somebody has died, so in a relative, but he has survived. So why I would not have been dying also? So that leads to the survival guilt. So all this guilt may tear one's patient or discharged into a world still reeling from the virus. But even though COVID-19 is a new disease, rehabilitation and health psychologists benefit from existing knowledge as they strive to help these patients in coping up in near future. So what are the psychosocial care after infectious disease of pandemic? The importance of providing mental health service to people affected by the epidemic of infectious disease are highly recognized by the academic society of all over the world. Tools to achieve mental health and wellness are restoring basic services and security for affected populations, strengthening family and community network, providing distressed individuals with psychological support that you are not alone, we are with you. All the people who are suffering of this disease, they are going to have the same problem, same suffering. So you are not alone. We are here to provide you psychological help. Providing specialized mental health intervention for severely affected survivors, those who need counseling. So mental health worker or clinical psychologist can go for counseling. So strategies to tackle problem, specific method included establishing professional psychological intervention team, which consisted all medical mental health professionals, including psychiatrists, conducting online psychological counseling and services, etc. Under the guidance of government, we were required to pay attention to patients' mental health and psychological responses. Psychological evaluations, counseling, and supporting should be provided to recovered patients. Psychological intervention delivered by occupational therapists, social worker, or rehabilitation psychologists may be required for patients with depression, anxiety, or those who are having post-traumatic stress disorders. Possible strategies targeting to the general population as well as the early intervention, including psychological support, psychotherapies, supportive, and pharmacological treatment, those who are highly depressed, those who need help or having the suicidal intention or suicidal idea, to vulnerable and high-risk groups can be provided or given. Systemic and well-designed intervening trials with strict evaluation of outcome, if possible, could also be set to a light on the development of strategic and models of prevention of PTSD among people affected by epidemic or other infectious diseases. Now, so how you can take care of mental health during the pandemic? That step one, try to apply for media and find a balance. Whatever I have said, don't go for breaking news all along. Don't sit in front of the media house. Don't sit in front of your TV all along and cut down your social network. Take a time, at least for only 15 to 20 minutes for your task. Aware of that daily happenings. Don't go for after half an hour or 1 hour, don't go for review of the news or breaking news. But number two, physical distancing does not mean being alone. Physical distancing does not mean that psychological distancing. Yes, that government has banned the physical distancing, that has asked for physical distancing, but their government has not asked for your social or psychological distancing. We can communicate you are near and dear. We can communicate through the via social WhatsApp group, via Facebook, via phone. We can keep communicating. So keep connected with your loved one. Third is, you are not alone. That same phenomena, whatever the problem is happening in India, whatever problem is happening in Assam, whatever the problem is happening in Kerala, whatever problem is happening in UK, USA, Germany, Italy, Spain, everywhere. So all of us are the same boat of brother. So that is why, so we are not alone. So if we have to face, so we have to face all together alone. So that is why we are not alone. We have to face it together, and that will lead us to our victory. But this is a step for who know that this is not easy. So when it will go, how long it will stay? Yes, nobody knows. But nobody knows. But time is the great deliverer. Time will heal everybody. Not alone. So it will go sometimes. And what I say, although lockdown is there, although the night curfew is there, we have to keep our health active. So go for walking, or go for keep your health, keep your physical activity intact. Now, we have talked about that psychological health. So there may be two ways how psychological counseling can be given. It can be individual level, or it can be given in the government level. The Assam government has started its psychological counseling in the name of Manon. So Manon is your a kind of psychological counseling. We used to give it those who are suffering from COVID positive, those who are in acute trauma, those who are in acute distress, those who have misunderstanding, those who are scared or scared of disease, or those who are in panic. So acute stage, and we are going to continue it till the recovery, till the COVID pandemic is going on. And it is the government-sponsored organizations, more than thousands psychological counselors are working, including psychiatrists and clinical psychologists and psychiatric social worker. And everything has been given the direction. So helpline is 104. So everybody can contact with 104, and they will be installed. They will be given some phone number, and that psychologist will contact them for their help. Now, so apart from this counseling, we can go for cognitive behavioral technique. Say for those who are having the guilt feeling regarding COVID survivors. So that you are not responsible for your disease. Anybody can have the disease, and you are not guilty, you are not fault. You should not be shamed enough. That is called cognitive behavior therapy. Then you can go for relaxation strategies or breathing exercise or Jacob's sounds. Those who are in clinical psychologists, they know. Those who are counselor, they also know it's a simple breathing exercise. The psychologist can focus on the emphasis on other health habits like such as nutrition and sleep hygiene, especially during the pandemic time. It is not like that it is all school and college are closed, so you have to get awake in the whole night and sleep in the morning. It's not like that. So by 11, you should be at bed, and by 6 or 7, you should get up. So group therapies and motivation interview can be done in a group wise. Patient who survived COVID-19 should be equipped with tools to navigate the questions and curiosity of well-meaning loved one and bystanders. General education regarding the disease and the rationale for quarantine and public health information provided to the general public. Why this 14 days quarantine is necessary? Because this is the virus. During that period, the virus can grow. So that is why he died. Make himself to make the others safe of his family member. This 14 days quarantine is absolutely necessary, and that is why people have to live in a quarantine at least for 14 days. So it is said that counseling can be given in case of your reduced stigmatization, because those who are having COVID-19, they have been stigmatized. I'll come to it later on. Whereas more detailed information targeted to schools and workplace might also be useful. It may also be told media, reporting contribution to the stigmatized issues in the general public. The media is a powerful influence on public attitude and dramatic headlines and fear. Engineering have been shown to contribute to the stigmatization attitude in the past. So naming the individual, there are such and such people as COVID, he has infected so many people. So this should be condemned, and they should not report like that. So need for public health officials to provide rapid and clear message delivered effectively for the entire affected population to promote accurate understanding of the situation. And in this case, the digital media allows them your written media, newspapers, has a great role to play. Now, let me share something about three slides on this aspect. So these people, those who are COVID survivors, they are the most vulnerable to develop stigma in regarding to COVID-19. Stigma is not made by the COVID, it is the man-made disease. A study found that COVID-19 confirmed patients suffer severe mental distress even after rehabilitation and discharge, because stigma from adults was a major problem associated with COVID-19 survivors, often continuing for some time after quarantine and discharge. People does not approach him, does not invite to any family gathering, does not invite to social gathering. Stigmatization and rejection from people of his neighborhood, from his family, from his neighbors, met the people, suggesting that there is a stigma, especially surrounding people who have been quarantined, that he might infect us. So people, that these people, although they have recovered, they are stigmatized, that they will spread the disease. COVID-19 survivors in several studies reported that adults were treating them differently, avoiding them, withdrawing social invitations, treating them with fear and suspicion, and making critical comments that he is a COVID-19, he is corona, something like that. Some of the people were being unable to resume their job after getting discharged from hospital because their employment expressed fear of contagion. We have got so many patients. After the COVID, they have been discharged from the their duties, and they have been pushed or they have been sent for long leave. So it is the time to correct myths, rumor, and stereotype. Why stigma against COVID? It's a new disease. People don't know about that. Anxiety, confusion, and fear among the public, and this factor fueling harmful stereotypes that yes, he's the responsible. What does stigma does to the individuals, drives public to hide their illness. That is happening in Assam. That is happening in Assam. That is happening all over the world. So in the beginning, in March, April, the government of Assam has conducted a home-to-home survey of 10,000 people. Only 3 people has been found they are having fever. So which is this error of the sampling, because everybody has collected, but people deny their illnesses. So deny that they are having any illness, and that is why that is the stigma. And if they say the right thing, if they will be taken to the your quarantine hospitals, and they will put there for 14 days, and that is why people scared of, and that is why people lies. And that is one of the most important why that is an example of stigmatization. So that prevents people from seeking healthcare immediately and discourages them from adopting healthy behavior. So what can be done? Not all who coughs or sneeze have COVID. Face fears and anxiety with facts and not by discrimination. Despite precaution, if anybody catches COVID, it is not their fault, because it depends upon individual immunity, depends upon individual environment, it depends upon individual comorbidity. Stay positive and take care of mental health. Do not stigmatize people in home quarantine. Remember, COVID-19 will be healed, but stigma and mental trauma left behind. Now, the same thing. So coronavirus and stigma. So coronavirus does not recognize race, religion, nationality, or ethnicity. So wearing a mask does not mean a person is ill. It is the protection of the self, and it is the protection to the others. It is my sensitivity that I also own infect, and I don't allow anybody to infect on my behalf. Stop stigma by sharing accurate information. Speak up if you hear, see, or read discriminating comments. So you should be bold enough and show compassion and support for those most closely impacted. So solidarity, so your empathy. So this is the another example how we can do in the local level, how we can do in the society level. So this is the leaflet organized by Assam Psychiatric Society, Indian Psychiatric Society Division Bands, and this is the leaflet. So we used to distribute. So how stigma can be removed? So all the cause of stigma is basically the ignorance. We don't know the disease. We don't know about all the things. That is why we are misled. we have stigmatized. So if we know correctly the nature of the illness, we are not making any stigma or there is no myth at all. So what are the future perspectives and in-depth understanding of various psychological approaches such as psychodynamic approach, person-centered approach, existential approach, cognitive behavior approach. Time does not allow me to talk all these things. But all these things, say for example, the existential approach. So this coronavirus has made us that what is the meaning of life? What is the essence of life? What is the essence of life? A 30 years old man also died and 65 years old men also died. What is the essence? So essence of life is that whatever the period, whatever the period we are living, we live as a boldly. We have live as a bravely. Let us live as much as possible, taking care of ourselves and others. So ongoing research work related to COVID-19 would probably give us a better insight into the psychological impact of the pandemic people. New research should be focused on identifying the extent and psychological issues, recognizing acute and long-term psychological issues. And this world aid in policy making and efficiently tackling mental health issues in the post-COVID area.
Hello, so, sir.
Last but not the least, the last slide, virus does not discriminate and neither should we. Solidarity, not stigma, hides the spread of coronavirus. Thank you so much for your patience hearing. Thank you all. This is my references. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. So thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
You have given us such informative information that we really, participants definitely have a lot of take-home messages. And as you say, that corona is pandemic, not that dangerous as so much the stigma is dangerous. So we have to really
we can't hear.
Ma'am, we can't hear you again. Ma'am, one. Hello.
Jay, can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am, now we can hear.
Okay, earlier you did not hear.
Yes, ma'am, but not audible.
Sorry for that. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your information. It was really very informative that we could learn a lot. And there are a lot of take-home messages. And as you said, Corona pandemic is not that dangerous. But the stigma is more dangerous, so we have to understand each other. Thank you very much. So now I am coming to the next and last speaker of the day, and she is my friend. During my MSc at SNDT, she was a very good girl by her nature, I am saying. Of course, she was excellent in her study too. She has completed her PhD from Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences, Krishna University, MSc Medical Nursing Gold Medalist from LTC and SNDT Women's University. As I said, same time I did. Has 20 years in various faculty positions. In 2004, she served as the second investigator in a TNI co-sponsored research in the state of Maharashtra. Received the first prize in thesis category amongst all faculties at Maharashtra University of Health Sciences for research presentation during Avishkar Convention 2010. also bagged the first prize in teachers level among the medicine and pharmacy category at MUSS for research presentation during Avishkar Convention 2015. In 2016, she was chosen to guide two students from University Montreal pursue their internship studies. She received the Bharat Vidya Srimani Award and Certificate of Education Excellence for outstanding achievement and remarkable role in the field of education on December 18, 2015. And she is going to deal with the topic exist towards the affliction faced by the community during the COVID-19 pandemic. We have discussed about the healthcare provider, we have discussed about the COVID warrior, and also we have discussed about the COVID survivor. Now we are coming to the community. Community is the future, community that we have to look forward. And I'm looking forward to hear from the Madam Rita. Please, over to you. Hello, Rita.
Now, Rita ma'am, please unmute the mic.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
The screen is also visible?
We can hear you and we can see also.
Okay, thank you, dear. Thanks for that lovely introduction, Dr. Unmona. Good afternoon to all of you all. It's a pleasure to be with all of you, and it is such a pleasure to be part of this important conversation. My earlier speakers couldn't have said it better with regards to the pain experienced by the various people and where we are as a nation, particularly when we are grappling with COVID-19. My topic falls along the same lines, and I'm here to discuss with you all about a gist towards the affliction faced by the community during the COVID-19 pandemic. I do agree there is affliction, but let me start with a positive note. I personally feel there's always a healing response to uncertainty, this uncertainty that COVID has given us. What I propose to do quickly in the next 20 minutes is I would share with you all the afflictions that community has faced during this COVID-19 pandemic, and I would also share with you all certain evidence-based practices in context to healing. I'm sure we all of us know that affliction is a condition of great distress, pain, or suffering that could be related to a disease or a grief over years because of our COVID-19 disease. When we look at affliction, we also should see how is the community really doing. So these are a few quotes that have fallen on my ears over and again, and perhaps you will agree with me that most of you all would have also heard it. This is undoubtedly a stressful time for a lot of people. We are going through a collective traumatic experience. We find ourselves evaluating what's working and what's not working in our lives, whether personally or professionally. We are constantly seeing people around us who are hurting and suffering. There's a need to help ourselves and to help others and find purpose. And this process can be overwhelming, mentally draining, traumatic, further because no outcome can be seen. I'd like to share about certain statistics and figures before I go ahead with respect to community affliction. Nearly 7 in 10 employees indicated in a survey by mental health provider Ginger that the coronavirus disease 2019 is the most stressful time of their entire professional career, which is aligned with stark increases in new prescriptions of antidepressants, anti-anxiety, and anti-insomnia medications. Published in an article by Human Resource Executive, findings indicate not only the stress-induced impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on employees, but its major implications are for employers as well. According to Ginger, 88% of workers reported experiencing moderate to extreme stress over the past 4 to 6 weeks. Among those reporting stress, 62% noted losing at least 1 hour a day in productivity, and 32% lost at least 2 hours a day due to COVID-19 related stress. This was the research which was done in April 2020. I move ahead to another research which is very interesting related to our topic. It is being done by KFF Health Tracking Poll, and they wanted to understand the amount of mental stress that community people have underwent. So the first question they put across to the community people was, do you feel that worry or stress related to coronavirus has had a negative impact on your mental health? And they found that people said in the month of March, 14% had a major impact, 18% had a minor impact. Again, this poll was done in the month of April, early April, and they found the impact had increased. 19% had a major impact and 26% had a minor impact. Now, in the month of May, you can find some amount of resilience. You will find that 12% had a major impact and 27% had a minor impact. Now, with respect to April results, 19% major, 26% minor, the study further went ahead to see what was the impact in terms of gender, race, and whether the people group had parent, was a parent less than eight, had a child less than 18 years of age, or was not a parent. So they found the impact was major on females. They also found the impact was more on Black and Hispanic people, and they also found that the parents of who were having children less than 18 years or not a parent had almost equal amount of impact. Now, those who had children, they wanted to go ahead further and find out whether the impact was on the male parent or the female parent. So they found the female parent was more affected with stress as compared to the male parent. Moving ahead, they wanted to see whether the impact was related to the socioeconomic status. So when they found the household income was less than 40K, the impact was greater. The impact was almost equal with respect to people who were earning average income as compared to people who were in the higher bracket. With respect to impact on their mental health in context to the health status, they found that people
Anita,
who
had,
yes,
hello.
Yes,
we can see only your first slide. Only your first slide is in.
It's not moving?
Not moving.
No, but I have shared it. It is showing sharing.
I don't know. It's okay, otherwise continue. But it is showing only the first slide. Otherwise you continue, we can hear you.
Ma'am, you need to slot it, ma'am.
Yeah, it's fine now.
It's fine? Okay.
Yeah.
So now I had moved on. I had moved on to the fifth aspect of the research, which said they wanted to see whether the impact was more in respect to the health. How was the impact with respect to the health status? So they found the impact was more on people who had fair or poor health, and people who had good health, the impact was comparatively less. I'm not able to change my slides. Something has gone wrong. Is it possible that you all can share from there?
Vijaya, can you do it?
Can you all share from there if you don't mind?
Vijaya, can you share
it? Because I think...
Ma'am, can you please send...
Rita, ma'am. Rita, madam, you just have to move from the finger. It will move the slide next, madam.
Yeah, I've used the Zoom platform quite a number of times, but somehow it's. I'll try once again. No, it's not moving. It's not moving. Can you share it from there, please?
Ma'am, I need your PPT, ma'am.
Otherwise, you continue, Rita. We can hear. That's all right. If you can see by yourself.
Okay.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. Fine. So I have covered with respect to household income. I've covered with respect to health. And now they wanted to know whether those people who had stress, whether they had stress earlier before the pandemic, and they found 11% of the people had stress before the pandemic and 35.5% had it only because of COVID. So we can very clearly make out that this pandemic has given us stress. We also moved ahead to find out whether the people felt the mental health services were good prior to the pandemic, and many people said the mental health services were not good prior to the pandemic, so the condition is more worse now. Now, looking at this research, what must come to your mind is, this is done in a country abroad, it's not in India, so if the situation is so bad abroad, what it would be in India? Moving ahead, let's see what are the causes of affliction in the community. So the most important cause that this coronavirus, COVID virus, has given us is many, many problems. Modi's hasty announcement of the unprecedented lockdown gave hundreds of millions of Indians less than 4 hours to prepare. In an address to the nation, he said, forget about leaving home for the next 21 days. If you cross the threshold of your house, you will invite the virus home. It has thrown much of the country into chaos. We will use up the little we have saved to get through this, said one person. What happens after that, I do not know. I leave it to God. Modi assured Indians that essential services would continue, but was vague regarding how people would be able to buy food and other necessary items. As a result, people rushed through shops to stock up before the decree took effect. People were seen lining up outside stores late into the night, and traffic congestion was reported across the country. The lockdown had triggered a massive exodus of migrant laborers and wage workers from cities back to the rural villages they are from, where many won't have to pay rent and food is cheaper. Many migrants were seen defying the curfew. Some have told news outlets that they were walking up to 500 miles to get back home. Videos of chaotic scenes at train stations showed people struggling to get onto their last train, some crying uncontrollably as they missed them. Overcrowding at public transport stations have raised concerns about further spread of the virus. Mass congregations like this carried the risk of spreading COVID-19 even further. The worry was that migrants might carry the virus to rural areas where health infrastructure is already weak or even non-existent. The lack of clear risk communication from top leadership and mixed messages from across the system spooked the poor migrants who chose to start uncertain journeys. The exodus of migrants may have spread out the virus far and wide, adding another layer to India's problem. But for majority of the Indians, social distancing is a luxury they can't afford. Many face hunger and starvation in the absence of daily wages that have been disrupted as the world's seventh largest economy grinds to a halt. Many said, khichdi is the only menu that we have most of the days. On March 26, India announced a £22.5 billion relief package to help the country's poorest people sustain and feed themselves. The government plans to use existing welfare schemes to roll out the relief measures, which include free food distribution and cash transfers to millions of low-income families across the country. As part of relief measures, low-wage earners, like, for example, Kumari, got just 500 rupees. She was earning 4,000. Now she worried, how is she going to take care of her family members? Auto rickshaws, drivers, milkmen, vendors who sell vegetables, snacks from carts, all part of this economy. Most live on daily wages, do not receive any benefits, and work jobs that do not exist on paper. India's economy was already struggling with slumping growth. The growth had come down drastically. Even some businesses that are thriving elsewhere in the world are hampered in India. For example, the famous Dabbawala have worked rain or shine to deliver people's home cooked lunches to their stakeholders for almost 130 years now. They have braved heavy floods and terrorist attacks, but services were halted. Let's look at the plight of the woman. Governments across the world have implored people to stay home while failing to even acknowledge the increased domestic responsibilities created by the lockdown. The home now includes children who are compelled to be at home all time, including aged people who are especially vulnerable to the virus and babies that cannot be babysat by willing neighbors anymore. This is possible because this burden has traditionally been borne and continues to disproportionately be borne by women of the household. The difference is even more skewed for Indian women who do more unpaid care and domestic work than women in any other country. Indian women spend up to 353 minutes a day on household work, which is 577% more than the 52 minutes spent by men on it. Factors such as double shifts for working women, the absence of assistance of house help, and the increased need of cooking, cleaning, caring, hygiene has skewed balance of domestic work today. Come to the students. With respect to students, I have more questions to offer than to describe their affliction. All schools will require support in terms of resources and policy, way beyond the current problems. There is issue of timetabling because there may be three children, and how do you make sure that the timetabling is accordance to each one's availability and access to devices, and the parents have the ability to share those with their children? We may have to go beyond guidelines now. For example, protocols like when do we call the parent, when do we call the child, what sort of data protection people have to be aware of, what data is going to be made visible and available, what kind of video recordings are to be allowed. The whole issue is to let children know who don't have much exposure to social media as to what kind of footprints they are creating. What kind of a student-teacher interface needs to happen? How does a teacher ensure there is enough happening in terms of questions and formative assessments and be able to get informative responses from children to be able to see whether they are available, attentive with you or not? How capable are our children of independent learning? Now, parents can be support and teachers can be facilitators, it is said. Our parents haven't time for this. We will have to see how technology can be led by pedagogy. The quality will depend on the experience the child has, and that will depend on the teacher. Are the teachers prepared for that? Parents will have to support in learning, will have to know how to keep their children safe online, and that is one of the biggest challenge. And they will have to learn what kind of platforms are offered to children. They will have to become the conduit between the teacher and the child. Possibly, how to create this ecosystem where the child can learn. Going ahead, this is another instance which happened in our community. When the businessman tested positive, his misery multiplied. Gates to his home in the colony were sealed soon after the home under quarantine notice by the district authorities went up. By the next morning, street vendors stopped selling fruits and vegetables to them. Their cleaning staff stopped coming. Photographs of the notice and rumors about how he may have been infected started to circulate on the colony's WhatsApp group. See the stigma that people went through. Look at our India's growth trajectory since 2011. It was just coming up, just pulling itself up. Now it's dipped to the lowest since 2011. Layoff notices being given. We also feel COVID is going to be a syndemic. So there is one pandemic is giving birth to another pandemic. So we need to be cautious whether it's going to come with malaria, whether it's going to come with any other infections. Deaths of despair, unemployment, isolation. Do we think that isolation is healthy? We could be having a lot of impact. Uncertainty. We do not know where this is going to go, how many years it's going to be with us. Delayed test results. People waited for so long to get their results. And again, that caused them such a lot of anxiety. Mental illness is an epidemic. So today we find this all coming in our papers. Though in US, National Resilience Strategy programs are in action, but yet, even after being in action, there's a lot of mental health problems. Imagine the condition that's going to exist in India. It is said unmet need for mental health services reflects in several interconnected policy issues. Let's take the first policy issue, financing and organization of care. Did we have insurance coverage when we fell sick? Did our hospitals provide all the care that was required by us? We had nurses, doctors in PPE. We couldn't look at them. We couldn't see them. We were having such a lot of fear. Look at the, did we have ease of using the different services that were available in the hospital? Did everybody have the cultural competency to give care? Looking at the social and individual factors, non-financial access barriers, huge transport problem. Patients had to be empowered because we had to control the pandemic, the stigma, the demand and need, the economic crisis that everybody faced, the mobility crisis, the drugs, they shifted up to 40,000. From 5,000 to 40,000 and 50,000. These all added to our stressors. Trauma is experienced in the wake of COVID by an overwhelming amount of general public because of loss and grief, because of isolation, because of paranoia, because of increased exposure to abusive living, because of overwhelmed healthcare systems when they had inadequate drugs, when they had inadequate ICU beds, and perhaps even simple beds where patients were getting admitted. See the amount of plastic waste that is getting generated today. Let's have a look at the signs and symptoms of affliction. I think my earlier speakers have already covered it. I've just put a few over here. So losing sleep, difficulty talking about feelings, worried, dreaming about COVID trauma experiences, feeling of hopelessness, diminished feelings of personal and professional satisfaction. So let us see, has the community got resilience? The previous research that I discussed with you all showed some amount of resilience. How can we enhance this resilience? So it's important, primary care. We need to integrate our medical and behavioral health with mental health. Primary care is a part of contact tracing. So when we went for contact tracing, it was important for us to even see how much amount of mental health is being affected of the people. Proactive primary care, reaching out to our patients who are unable to come to the office. Telehealth, again, that has to be proactive and responsive in screening, referral, treatment, and counseling. Stigma reduction. How many of us pick up trucks in your parking lot? If we ask people like that, I'm sure they will not stigmatize those people who have been affected. Community participation, and that's the most important buzzword. We cannot come out of this pandemic without complete community participation. This is a prediction based on the past. It is not destiny. We can change the trajectory and we can prevent deaths of despair. The current isolation is unprecedented. We need to have policies of new ways of connecting with people because we are, after all, socially human beings. Mental health must be a part of any COVID-19 recovery testing and tracing efforts. We need to train all those tracers on basic mental health evaluation and referral. So the perspective is changing. There is resiliency. There is hope. What does this look like now? So let's look at the coping skills of people. We need to recognize whether people have healthy coping skills or unhealthy coping skills. This has also been covered by my previous speakers. So healthy coping skills are art, music, reading, prayers, journaling, exercising, meditating, talking. And I'm sure many, many organizations have come forward in supporting and disseminating this information to all of us. Unhealthy is overeating, compulsive spending, dissociation, detachment, isolation, overworking, irregular sleep patterns, self-harming behavior. We need to be conscious of these unhealthy behaviors. So let us see what are the healing response to uncertainty. It starts with embracing healing from a place of hope. We have to accept that I need to heal myself. Tuning into our emotions and experiences and acknowledging that what we are facing is okay. So we, all of us are stressed. We need to tell ourselves, yes, that's okay. Acknowledge your emotions. Recognize that you do not have to have everything figured out to move forward. It is during the most challenging times that your grit comes through the most, allowing yourself flexibility. Be willing to bend, but don't break. Your traumatic experience and grief is unique to you. Stay put to you and heal it. Evidence-based practices, a guide to your healing journey. So mindfulness, we always tell people, stay tuned to your present. The moment you stay tuned to your present and accept your experiences, don't avoid them, you will find healing automatically sets in. progressive muscle relaxation. Grounding. It's very important that we have effective coping technique from anxiety using this grounding. When we stop naming things that we see, feel, hear, smell, and taste, and we get grounded to our emotions. It's very important that we heal ourselves and we liberate ourselves, we will empower ourselves. Every scar that you have is a reminder not just that you got hurt, but that you survive. It has been said by Mrs. Michelle Obama, first lady. Now let me take you once again through an update on business. Limit checking updates. You must check your updates from trustworthy sources. Step away from media if you feel overwhelmed. Be careful what you share, but stay connected. Follow recommendations of hand hygiene, social distancing, universal masking. Write down your worries. Think of practical solutions. Be very, very kind to yourself. Ayush system will come in. See fit. Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better. It's not. This is a quote given by Dr. Suez. So it's important that you care for yourself. Judith Furman has also said, atrocities refuse to be buried. Remembering and telling the truth about terrible events are prerequisites both for restoration of the social order and for the healing of individual victims. So get acquainted, get in touch with the terrible events and heal yourself. Collective trauma leads to collective sentiments. Observe the community around you. Are they going through a collective trauma in response to the current pandemic? This is a nice graph which shows the factors that are involved in risk and resilience. So if you find people are having more adversities, then they are more vulnerable, they will not move to residence. So look at these people like poverty, homelessness, unemployment, racism, cultural marginalization, community fragmentation, community violence, domestic violence, maltreatment, children who are not cared for, minimal daily structure, comfort eating, too much media, minimal exercise, emotional isolation, self-focused, sleep disruption, negative and ruminating. So if you find all this is chaotic, it is severe, it's prolonged, it's uncontrollable, then people will not move to resilience. So we need to pull them out from the resilience. And we pull them out and move, change their pattern of stress when we see that their daily structure is more organized. Their family meals are together. There is limit of media, there is exercise, they reach out to people, they help others. There is good sleep hygiene and mental hygiene. There is positivity, there's for future they are focused. So they are moving more to resilience. They are moving more to the bright light, to the sunlight, to reduce their stress. To conclude, I would say the brain is malleable and we can use interpersonal neurobiology to promote healing and positive influences. This leads to brain growth and to repair. I acknowledge this presentation, which I've taken from NRCDC, NRCDV, Community Healthcare Healing Session. I've taken a few content from there. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Edmona, for giving me this platform to share my thoughts.
Thank you very much, Rita. You can hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, because I had a lot of issues from the very beginning, like for the first time after so many years. Anyway, I have learned a lot to how to have the backup and all. Anyway, it is very nice that now very well you have summarized, like, you know, covering the whole community up to the schools, like, you know, pandemic will go, it will pass on for a couple of days or a couple of months or a couple of years, that I don't know. But if we do not take care of the emotional well-being, it will have a long-lasting effect on us. We will not be able to come up with that effect. So it is very important for us to nurture our community and to understand each individual emotional being, and we have to help each other how to carry the emotional toolbox. I always say we always carry a first aid box in the car. When we have the physical problem, we have the box at our home, And when we have the bank at our financial things at home, we have our friends to call. But when our inner being goes down, it will really will take a lot of time to come up. So we have to really nurture the spiritual being too, and understanding each other, holding the hand of each other, it is very important. So with this, I extend my deepest gratitude to you for taking out your time for delivering your session with us. Thank you, Rita.
Thank you.
I also thank from my side for moderating this scientific session, and I seek pardon from Ma'am Manchi that I could not start the beginning due to the technical problem. And I again extend my deepest gratitude to you, Ma'am Manchi, that you are so busy, having so hectic schedule, that you have been extend your hand with us to collaborate with us, and you are here throughout this session. And I extend my deepest gratitude to Madam Professor Deepika Deka, Vice Chancellor of Srimanta Shankar Deva University of Health Science, who really thought that, like, you know, we can do something with the AINE, we can do something for the nursing. Her words, her thoughts and words made the day today. And also I'd like to mention one very specific thing for Manchi ma'am. One day she said to me, I want to walk with you. Like, probably ma'am, this is the beginning I walk, but I'm very sorry I could not give you the best the way you expected. And in future, looking forward, and I'll try my best to do my work nicely. So thank you very much. And please pass on my message of gratitude to Madam Deepika Deka. So because she spent her time over here, she was here with us and inaugurated the session. And anyway, the whole program is over to you, Ma'am Manchi.
Thank you, Dr. Udmona. You are always a bundle of positive energy for us, and it is really infectious. Thank you for all those beautiful words that I've spoken just now. You've almost summed everything up, and I don't have much to speak. Anyway, I have been entrusted with the privilege of proposing the vote of thanks. So I'm going to do this duty. Although I wouldn't like this program to end, because, you know, vote of thanks is, means that the program is going to end. Anyway, a duty is a duty. So at the outset, I would like to thank our chief patron, Professor Deepika Deka, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Srimata Sankara Deva University of Health Sciences. We are grateful to you, ma'am, for being here with us, for inaugurating this lovely session, and for being the solar energy that never fails to stimulate the minds of the listeners or the viewers. Next, I would like to thank our other patron, Professor Gokul Chandra Das, who is the officer on special duty of SSCVHS, who would have been here but for a personal problem that he has had. And we thank you, sir, for being the supportive pillar and for coordinating this event so well with AINE. Next, of course, we would like to give a huge thanks to Dr. Unmona Borgohain Saikia, who is the Dean, Faculty of Nursing. We are happy that you have joined as Dean, Faculty of Nursing of SSCVHS, and the Principal AINE, and also the Organizing Chairperson of the beautiful evening today. We are also thankful to Bijaya Thongam, the Organizing Secretary of this session here, for all taking care of all the nitty-gritties from the biggest to the smallest, and incorporating them into this event so well. Next, we would like to thank all the other members of the organizing committee and all the members of AINE. And of course, a special thanks go to the resource persons whose scintillating variety of topics, the elocution, the breathtaking deliberation has been like a rainbow in the horizon of knowledge. We thank all of you, Dr. Lalu Joseph, Dr. Pratima Naik, Dr. Suresh Chakrabarty, Dr. Rita Lakhani, for giving your valuable time here and enriching us with all your knowledge and sharing with us. Next, of course, the most importantly, we would like to thank the participants from far and wide who have joined today, and the thirst of knowledge which has brought them here to this webinar to share this platform with. So successful. Thank you very much. Over to Unmona for your closing remarks, please.
No, you have so beautifully started and beautifully concluded. I was amazed to hear your last few words also, like, even feeling like hearing more and more. Even I am feeling the same. I don't want to end it now. So this is only my thank you to all the participants and bearing with me all this inconvenience. That's all from my side. Thank you. I think we can come to the end.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay then, thank you very much once again.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.